As a business owner, presenting from stage, on video, or in an interview is a marketing strategy not to be ignored. Join Griffo and I as we explain exactly how to nail it.
Well, I said, welcome to a small business marketing show, where successful small business owners share their souls to take your marketing straight to the lead. Now, here's your host, Mr. Timbo Griffo.
Welcome back, listeners, to another episode of Australia's number one marketing show. I'm your host, Timbo Reid. You, however, so much more importantly, well, you're a motivated business owner.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming you're ready to crank out some great marketing, because that is exactly what we do on this show. If you are new to it, you are about to enter the marketing journey of a lifetime. Welcome. If you're not new to it, I love you for listening in. Thank you. Hey, we're brought to you by the very good folk at Key Person of Influence, by the way, which is the world's leading accelerator program for business owners just like you who want to be considered and become industry thought leaders. And it's not as hard as you think it is, thanks to their five-step process, each one starting with a P, which is kind of clever. You can learn how to do it through their Amazon bestseller. I'm going to give you one for free, a hard copy. Yep, in the post. Head over to keypersonofinfluence.com/Timbo. Hey, big show today. Griffo and I get together on an episode of Funny Business and share some solid insights into how you can go about adding presenting to your marketing arsenal. And we don't just mean presenting from stage. I think you're going to enjoy this one. I've got an example of some remarkable marketing recently achieved by a longtime listener and forum member. It's fantastic. So brilliantly simple, yet high impact. Motivational marketing quote of the day will put a smile on your dial. And if that's not enough, later on in the show, I sing a Rod Stewart song. I know, you can't wait for that, but you're going to have to. Don't fast forward. As per usual, there is marketing G-O-L-D, except for the Rod Stewart singing bit, dripping from the ceiling over here at Small Business Big Marketing's HQ. So let's get stuck right in.
Do you need a speaker for your next conference? Recommend Timbo to your event organiser. Or better still, book him. Tim Reid, that's reid.com.au.
Hey, how's this for some remarkable marketing? Following on from last episode with Arthur Greeno. So I've got a forum member, Dave. He owns a company called My Launch Kits, and he is a motivated business owner, I've got to tell you. And he made this post in the forum this week. I think it's just such a great marketing success story. He says, how's this for a win? Now, it's all about getting his brand on a really big fantasy football show on the ESPN network in America. Now, he tells me fantasy football is absolutely huge, and clearly ESPN is probably the biggest sporting network, if not in America, in the world. And he says the host of this fantasy football show is a guy called Matthew Berry. And he used to have a little toy berry that squeaked. He called it the bitter berry. And if one of his players did poorly, he'd squeeze the toy into the microphone declaring, I'm squeezing the bitter berry because player X didn't do so well. So here's where it gets interesting. The show recently moved their studio, and in the move, the toy berry was lost. Oh, toy, poor toy berry. I went to the local pet store, says Dave, and found a squeaky berry toy to replace it. I like his thinking. I also bought a few other squeaky toys that represented the other hosts of the show. One of the guy's name is Secret Squirrel, so I bought a toy squirrel that squeaked. Don't know how you find one of those. Anyway, he did. I put all of them in a box with a brief note on company stationery explaining that I love the show and play fantasy football often, and that I was upset to hear that the bitter berry was lost and wanted to replace it. I sent the package off last weekend and honestly never expected them to even get it or acknowledge it. I bet he secretly did. Come on, Dave. Today on the show, Matthew read my letter and everyone in the studio thanked me for the gifts. Matthew himself said, thank you, David Dumas, CEO of MyLaunchKits.com. How good's that? Needless to say, it was a thrill, and traffic to my website swelled. ESPN is a worldwide sports entertainment company, and a 30-second on-air commercial costs tens of thousands of dollars. It cost Dave less than $50 to do that. I love that idea. It's breaking the rules. It's thinking laterally. It's thinking outside of the box. And as I said in last episode with Arthur Greeno, I think more of us have got to think like that and get our little brands out into the big wide world and, you know, on ESPN and different things like that. I remember doing an episode a few years ago with a wonderful guerrilla marketer. He owns Messages on Hold. If you want to kind of pursue that guerrilla marketing tactic, I'll put a link in the show notes to it. I encourage you to start being more of a remarkable marketer like Dave. The support for this show comes from Key Person of Influence, a structured business accelerator program that's, well, not for everyone. Founder Glenn Carlson explains who KPI is ideal for.
Anyone that's built a business based around a skill, a talent, or an expertise where a lot of their revenue is reliant on them delivering that skill, talent, and expertise, we show them how to change gears from being the operator with a supporting business built around them to being an entrepreneur where the business is in fact operating and providing that value so they can take that step back and start to run the business instead of the business being designed to run them. We love working with a small business owner that's sitting on a mountain of value right now that they don't even recognise.
KPI, taking you from being a business doer to a business owner. Grab a free hard copy of their Amazon bestseller over at keypersonofinfluence.com/Timbo. Hey, just a quick one. I am speaking at a podcasting conference, the first podcasting conference in Australia. It's called We Are Podcast. It's on November 7 and 8 on the Gold Coast. You can check more out at wearepodcast.com. I'm speaking, Griffo speaking, Valerie Koo, great storyteller is Valerie, Nathan Chan from the Founder Podcast, Robert Gerrish from Flying Solo, lots and lots of podcasters. We're all sharing our stories and insights. So go and check out wearepodcast.com. Maybe I'll see you on the Goldie on November 7. Righto, let's get stuck in, well, not so much today's guest. He's just part of the furniture, really, is old Griffo. Griffo and I are getting together for another episode of Funny Business. And if you don't know who Griffo is, Andrew Griffiths, he's kind of like Australia's leading small business author. He's got 12 books under his belt, and he is a fellow speaker. So today's topic is around embracing the idea of speaking, of presenting in all its forms, not just on stage, and adding it to your marketing strategy. We talk about why you should, the various forms that it takes, and how to craft a great presentation. I think you're going to really enjoy this one. Now, Griffo's been doing a lot of presenting lately, and his voice is ever so slightly affected, as you're about to hear. So I started off by suggesting he sounds a lot like 70s rock god Rod Stewart. Now, Griffo, you sound a lot like Rod Stewart.
Thank you. I'm his better-looking younger brother, I would have to say. I've got the same long flowing hair as well. The problem is that most of it is flowing to the floor and gets swept up after I've brushed it.
How incredibly relevant the fact that we are talking about public speaking and small business today and you sound like some 70s rock god. Anyway.
Exactly, mate. Exactly.
Matey, I'm sorry to hear you crook, but and it is interesting. We will talk about the fact that your voice is pretty much, you know, you rely on it. We are chatting today about the fact that as small business owners, we really shouldn't be avoiding the idea of speaking, of public speaking.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's interesting, Timbo, from my perspective, I do a lot of speaker training and I do with groups of CEOs, small business owners, do all that kind of stuff. And I'm always intrigued to see who actually turns up to a speaker boot camp or something. And over the last 3 or 4 years, I've had everyone from priests to school teachers to chiropractors to builders to tradies to, you know, you name it, they've come along. And the reason being is that they're all saying they're getting asked to present more and more. You know, over time, they're asked to, you know, can you come and talk to us us about what you're doing in your business. Or they've got a pitch. They've got to get up in front of other people and sell their services. And I think there was always that time, and you and I have spoken about this in the past, where they would think, oh, well, speaking's not for me or presenting's not for me. That's, I just do what I do. Mm. But the reality is these worlds now are colliding. And if you can present about what it is you do in your story, that's a huge opportunity for marketing your small business.
Well, it's a huge opportunity in a number of reasons. It's a wonderful brand builder, personal brand builder.
Absolutely.
It's a wonderful way to actually get your message out in front of many. It's a great way to articulate your message, to actually get your pitch right. And we've had a couple of episodes of recent times. I had a bloke on recently, Oren Claff, who just specialises in nailing your pitch. And so the idea of getting up on a stage, as scary as it may be, is also a very, very wonderful marketing strategy. It can be free. You can even get paid to market your business. And, you know, I know one fellow, I won't say who it is, although he has been on this show. He does a lot of public speaking, and he, more than 50% of the reason he does it is because he gets to promote his product not only on stages in Australia, but around the world.
And whether you get paid or not, if you're using it as a promotional tool, is almost irrelevant. It's a bit of a bonus if you do. But I think these days, people want to know about businesses. They want to know the story. Everywhere we go, look at your podcast is about amazing businesses and amazing people telling stories. Podcasting is presenting. Whichever way you look at it.
So let's define presenting, because absolutely, we are not just talking about the idea of finding the nearest stage. We are talking about the fact that there's a lot of channels now, mediums for you, the small business owner, whether you are a vet or a masseur or a plumber, to...
Or all three.
Yeah, I know a lot of plumbers who are moonshining. Is it moonshining? Night? What's the word?
Moonlighting.
Moonlighting is masseurs.
Is making alcohol. Now, some of them may do that as well. I understand. A lot of pressure being a vet.
But, you know, this applies to you to find lots of different ways to get your message out there. So it could be, it very well might be a stage at the local Chamber of Commerce, but
absolutely,
yep, it could be a podcast. It could be a Google Hangout. It could be a webinar. It could be just a small group of people who admire what you do, and you may help train them up. I'm talking to a real estate agent tomorrow, the number one real estate agent in Australia, who actually spends a lot of time. You know, here's what he does. This is speaking. He brings young agents into his office, and they just watch him do his thing, and he sort of presents his how-tos in front of them. So lots of different ways of speaking.
Well, and I think more and more are appearing, and that's where I see a lot of great opportunity. I mean, I see now a lot of banks are doing things where they want to build a bit more of a relationship with the community, so they're inviting business owners to come along, and they'll get someone from the business community to talk about what they do. They're not necessarily looking for professional speakers to come to these smaller events. You know, even Rotary clubs, even not-for-profits and things like that, we sometimes underestimate the opportunity that we have by talking to those groups to actually tell them about our business. So even recording videos now, huge opportunity there, more videos. That's presenting. If you're standing in front of a camera presenting, then it's the same thing. So, yeah, there are plenty of opportunities. And, I mean, I think you would agree, mate, that in the next 5-10 years there'll be more and more and more, and people will want to see more from you as a business owner. So
you and I are both professional speakers, Griffo. We make a living from it. One of the things that I've noticed is that there's a whole lot of people entering the marketplace. Some are hoping to make a career out of it. Others are just happy to do it for free.
Yeah, well, a lot of those are doing it exactly as you said before, as a business development mechanism. They don't actually care if they get paid to speak. So as professional speakers, that's our competition now, is people not looking to get paid. They're happy to do it for free because they know it'll generate all this business back for them. That's just the world that we live in. So none of them are as good looking as us, though.
Awesome. Well, you sound good looking. You don't.
Thank you.
I can tell you right now, mate, you don't sound like you look. but I love yous anyway. So, Griffo, listeners are going, okay, yeah, this speaking thing, righto. So, hadn't considered it previously as a marketing strategy. There's some upside to it. It's not that easy. I'm not suggesting it's hard, but there's a whole lot of things to consider. Let's start by talking about not where or how you would go about getting some speaking opportunities, but what the hell would you say?
Yeah, isn't that a great question?
Great question.
And of course, the other one, that terrible statistic that always comes up about people would rather die in a fiery motor vehicle accident than talk in front of a group of people, which I've got to say is a seriously flawed statistic.
Very
I'm
flawed.
Sure.
Because basically what it says is they'd rather be in the coffin than make the eulogy.
Exactly.
Right?
And you kind of go, I don't quite believe that. I don't know where this, I think it's an urban myth. But anyway, there's no doubt people are a bit nervous about the whole idea of it. But I think one of the things that I've certainly found that's been wonderfully helpful for me as a presenter is to stop trying to be a perfect presenter.
Hang on, I'm just going to pull you back there, Tiger, because one of the things you're about to talk about personality and tone, but like, let's just figure out what is it that the business owner has to say. And many people go, oh, I've got nothing to say. No one would want to hear me speak, but you have.
Well,
you have.
Exactly.
You've got a story. Like, why have you got your business? Why have you started your business? You've got information about your industry, your products, your services that are going to help people make an informed decision. You've got anecdotes. There's so much.
Well, and that's actually where I was leading to. And before I was so brutally cut to the ground and
Come on, mate. Take a concrete pill. Let me just go and get a couple.
We worry that we've got to be this perfect presenter and we've got to, you know, be formal and all the rest of it. Whereas what people really do want to hear is exactly what you said, Tim. They want to hear your story, don't they? They want to know your struggles, your dreams, how you've done it, what you've got wrong, what you've buggered up, what you've got right, where you're going. And if you share that about your business, and I don't know, I've yet to meet a small business that doesn't have an interesting story of some sort, like why people got into it, how, you know, what was the reason behind it, whether they were corporate escapees or they've inherited the business or they just had this crazy notion one day to pack up their bags and move somewhere and start a dog grooming business.
It's a great place to start. And so, listeners, if you are looking at going, what do I do to craft a presentation? Let's just say right now, Griffo, you and I are helping them craft a 15 to 20 minute presentation.
Right,
a great place to start is story. We're talking about why. I'll give you a couple of examples of why. Like, and these are real examples. They're both relatively emotional examples. They don't have to be. One was with an insurance broker that I worked with, whose father passed away when the insurance broker was 17, and as a result, the family lost everything because the father had no insurance. So this fellow made a decision at the ripe old age of 17 that he was never going to let that happen to his family, and he became an insurance broker to help others. I've also met a photographer who also lost her two siblings at a young age, and all the family had were photos, and the importance that she placed on those photos was huge, and therefore she became a photographer. Now, the very short versions of those stories, but you can see how the telling of that story gets you to lean in and really listen to that business owner and why they do what they do, and then they can get on with sharing the rest of their message.
And just those two examples are just wonderful. I mean, I met a guy recently in Brisbane, and he was a third generation sausage maker, and he was in 85 thinking about retiring but not sure about handing the business over to these young whippersnipper grandson and son and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
And I said, you should be telling people this story. He goes, oh, who wants to listen? And we were in a room with about 100 people, and I asked him, who wants to hear Edwin's story?
Yep.
And, of course, everyone just put their hand up, said, hell yeah, we want to hear this guy's story. It's amazing. And we underestimate our own stories.
Mm.
You know, we ask, who wants to listen to us? It's not that big a deal. I get goosebumps hearing those two stories from a photographer and a life insurance.
And let's just be clear, they don't have to – those two were emotional, you know, soppy stories, but your story could be something that happened very recently. Your story could be a funny story. It could be whatever it is, but – I think, and Griffo, you do some speaking coaching. One of the things that I learned when working with my coaches last year, Troy and Zara, was that you needed to, in order to get a point across, you needed to have a story and or a funny. Now, in being a speaker, you don't have to be a stand-up comedian, but it does help if there is an opportunity to put a smile on someone's dial along the way. That's great. But if you go out, I'll give you an example. When I started working with Troy and Zara, the very first time we met, we'd spoken on the phone, but we hadn't met. And they said, righto, find us a boardroom in Melbourne and we'll meet you there. I thought, okay, we're just going to have a meeting. But what they did is they rolled up to this boardroom that I got hold of. They literally walked in and introduced themselves and said, okay, deliver your, give us your presentation. It was like, you know, there was no small talk. It was just like,
So, okay.
And I was ready to give the presentation. I thought we'd have half an hour. It's kind of just a bit of, you know, how are you? What about the weather? But my point here is this. But prior to getting speaking coaching, my presentation was full of valuable marketing facts and points, but that's all.
Yeah.
And what they
just data,
you know, told in a sort of half warm way. But what they forced me to do was create story. If I wanted to make a point around, if I wanted to make a point around social media, then I needed to find a social media story that was relevant to me that I'd experienced, and tell that first. Or make the point and then back it up with a story. And once you get that kind of sorted out, that method, gosh, speaking becomes fun.
And doesn't it? And when you realise and when you actually believe that people are interested in your story, that's the little voice in our head of who really cares what I've got to say? Who really wants to hear about how I started my business or why I've been passionate about doing this? No one cares. The reality is everyone cares. We live in a world that we're fascinated by people sharing their stories because we look for inspiration. And I think, too, the interesting part about what you're saying there, Tim, is the fact that no one wants someone to get on stage and go, oh, look, you know, isn't it a bitch to park your Lamborghini in this city? And my private jet today was, you know, I had to sack four people because there was a dirty serviette on there. Yeah. No one wants that story. No. They want a real story and they want an honest story and they want authenticity from you to share it. Whether you're an accountant, whether you're an astronaut, whether you're whatever it is, it doesn't matter. And that's, you're right about once you are comfortable telling your story, sharing your story, having a bit of fun with it, particularly the parts in it where you bug it up big time.
Yes.
And we've all got those. My life is one complete disaster that I've broken down into wonderful stories and hopefully you've learnt something from them.
Self-deprecating humour. Don't we love it, Griffo?
Exactly. And that's the key in whatever role you're doing. So you and I do this thing where we're always looking to turn it into a story that's going to be relevant and practical to the audience that you're talking to. And that's the key to being a great presenter in pretty much any corner of the world, in my view, mate.
This is so important. I mean, we're getting into workshop territory here, I know, but I know listeners find this kind of how-to stuff valuable is...
Yep.
Again, I just want to encourage anyone listening who's getting a little bit excited about the idea of presenting, don't think that you have to go and find the big story. Yeah. Stories can come from the most benign, I don't know which word's right there, Griffo, help me, but from every...
I don't think either of them are right, but we'll keep going.
There you go, authenticity, that's what we love. But from the smallest things, I've just finished, it was a good book. If you are interested in presenting, I've just finished Steve Martin's autobiography.
The comedian
Steve Martin, and it is a masterclass in presenting. And he had a moment in his stand-up comedy life where up until that point he was using other people's material, which a lot of comedians do, right? He made a decision one day that from that point on, he had like a 15, 20-minute act down pat, got lots of laughs, was earning him a little bit of dough. The turning point was when he said, as of today, all my material will be unique, right? And in order to do that, he had to start observing what was happening in his life. So he might go and sit in a cafe and watch someone order coffee. So if you're a cafe owner listening to this, sit back and look at the way people go about ordering coffee. A story that would come to mind immediately for me is when that person comes in and says, can I have a rice milk frappuccino, but just with the smallest splash of skinny milk with some, some ridiculous order. So you play that story out and then lead into a point around customer service where you need to be patient and you need to breathe, because as a cafe owner, we are given so many ridiculous orders, and as a coffee connoisseur, I want to punch that person in the nose. A simple observation, turned it into a story, and then made our point.
Well, and I think that as speakers, you and I, for example, we are looking for those stories every day. Every encounter, obviously we write a lot. I write a lot of articles, and I'm looking for that interaction in a coffee shop. You know, I wrote one last week, which was about seeing how badly treated this lady was in a coffee shop because she couldn't barely speak English, and she's trying to order a coffee, and the coffee shop owner was so disparaging towards her, and that to me, apart from the fact that he was a jerk, it just really pointed to me, that's a great article. It's something to talk about, the fact that we need to be considerate of our customers. You know, not everyone understands how the system works or the process works, and I can turn that into an anecdote for a presentation in some shape or form. And just opening your eyes to the good, the bad, seeing a simple someone doing something nice for someone else or whatever it might be.
Love it.
Is important. I've got two other tips that I would like to share. Can I share two tips?
Are they going to be life-changing for the listeners?
They are awesome.
Because they've downloaded this show onto their iPhone.
For everyone. And they have high expectations.
Hang on, mate. I haven't agreed to them yet.
Tell me what they
are.
Okay, so there's a TEDx video that everyone should check out, and it's by a guy called Matt Chen. Matt Chen, he's the guy who produces a TV show in America called Hoarders, and that's the one where there's a guy there who's got like 1,000 rats, and they're all members of his family. And, and people who haven't thrown anything out for 30 years. So this guy is hilarious. And he talks about, how do you capture an audience? How do you tell stories? How do you do that stuff? And he says two basic points. So the keys to capturing an audience, the first one is you've got to know your audience. Mm. And he said he knows his audience with Hoarders. They're people that are fascinated by gross stuff. And that's the same wherever you're going to go, you need to do a bit of research and know who you're going to be talking to make it relevant. And the second part of his, description is to start with what the audience knows and not what you know. And the way that I would use that as an example for anyone in the audience is if I'm talking to a room full of small business owners, I tell them, and some of you may have been to one of my presentations where I told the story, I start with the fact I talk about my first business. And I bought my first business, a dive shop in Sydney, when I was 17 going on 18. No idea what I was doing. 30 kilometres from the ocean. I was waiting for sea level to rise so it would be oceanfront. And I talk about how I got to know my bank manager, because every day he would drop by to say hello and give me all the checks that I'd bounced the day before. And it was just a tale of disaster of a guy who has no idea. And normally I say right about then, I bet you're all feeling pretty inspired to be here and getting words of wisdom from this this business hero. But what it does, it lets that small business audience know that I understand them.
It's an engaging story, and it's self-deprecating, and all that leads to, people sitting up and taking notice because, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but you get the sense that when you walk on stage, there's a part of human nature that's waiting for you to fail.
Well, I think that they actually want to see you succeed.
Yeah, bit of both, hey?
I think that because we've all seen, a bit of both. I think you're probably right there. I'll give you that one. But I think that we've all seen presenters fail badly on stage, and it's so embarrassing. It's like a train wreck. It's like
just want to go and kind of sort of sit alongside them and just rub their back,
give them a hug. It's like Miley Cyrus doing the Academy or the award show or whatever it is, and faux pas. But I convinced myself.
What are you doing watching Miley Cyrus? Do you stalk her on YouTube or something?
I decided that I had to increase my awareness of current affairs after the One Direction incident.
Wow.
And I started receiving emails. I got a CD of One Direction turn up in the mail after you outed me on an international podcast.
Oh, international podcast. Wow.
Griffo doesn't know who One Direction is.
Yeah, that's kind of interesting in itself, and there's a whole story there. This happened to me again yesterday. I interviewed a guy he's a franchisee at this Chick-fil-A franchise in America, sort of like a KFC type thing. So he owns Chick-fil-A franchise, and he didn't know what chicken salt was.
Really?
What's that about? Anyway, I digress, Griffo, but I tell you, I mean, chicken salt is God's gift to the culinary world.
I know, and Chick-fil-A, it's not quite as classy as KFC, I might add. See, the mongrel in me is coming out now.
Hello, Arthur Greeno, if you're listening. Goodness me. Anyway, mate, get back to your point because I've got one now.
Okay, so my point there, know your audience, do your homework, so you've got to know who you're talking to so you can tailor your talk, and then start with common ground, whoever they are. You just got to think that through. It doesn't have to be complicated, but common ground, you know, so that that the audience is connected with you from the beginning. So if I got up and gave that small business anecdote when I'm talking to a group of CEOs, I wouldn't connect with them. They go, well, we don't get it. We connect more with the bank. A manager, you're a bad risk. You know, it's a different kind of way. So that's two bits of tips. Two tips.
I'm a professional talker. Mate, okay, now, hey, one of the things that I want to address, because, okay, so far what I'm hoping is that there are some listeners out there going, okay, I'm going to start figuring out where and how I can go about presenting. It seems like a good marketing strategy. They're telling me I've got to create story. Now I'm shitting myself about getting on stage. Well, here's the thing, and Griffo's touched on it. Be yourself. If you are a nervous type, be nervous. If you fidget, then fidget a bit. Don't do Toastmasters. Hello, everyone at Toastmasters. But they'll tell you not to lean on the lectern, and they'll tell you not to put your hands in your pocket, and they'll tell you, and it's like, be yourself. Just be yourself and embrace your personality. I say to, you know, this is about brand building. I say to small business owners when we talk about brand building is that basically you are building a brand around your personality traits. So it's not that hard. You know what they are. I use the example of, excuse me, a guy who owns a bike store. His name's Pete, Pete's Bikes, and he does video marketing, and he is so nervous on these videos, Griffo, that you think, I don't really know whether you should be doing video marketing, but you watch them, you give him 15, 20 seconds, and you start to love the guy because he's just being him. So take the pressure off yourself. Don't go and find your marketing or presenting voice and try and elocute every word within an inch of its life because that will end in disaster.
Well, and when you stop trying to do that, and you actually just do exactly what you said, just be yourself, it's amazing how much pressure you take off yourself as well. And the audience just gets it. Everyone resonates with that. I had a really interesting experience last week. I was presenting at a conference on the Gold Coast. And there was a panel, oh, not a panel, but an interview as part of this conference. And there was a guy who was a public servant was going to be interviewing Rosie Batty, who the Australian of the Year, the lady had that her son was killed by her ex-partner in that terrible domestic violence situation. So there was like 300 or 400 people in the room, and this chap who was asking her questions and interviewing her on stage contacted me a couple of weeks beforehand. He wanted a bit of coaching. And he said to me, you know, one of the problems that I've got about doing this is that I kind of feel like I'm a man interviewing this lady about domestic violence, and it feels like I'm part of the problem, and I feel really like I'm representing all men and this complicated feeling and emotion about it. And he said, I just don't know how to get past that. And I said to him, that's what you open with. You say that because every man in the room can relate to that. We all get that. We all understand exactly that awkwardness that you feel when this poor lady is talking about how her husband, you know, beat their son to death with a cricket bat, you know, and you kind of look at that and go, wow, okay. So, you know, talked about the elephant in the room, and he did, and it was, you felt a shift in the room automatically. Everything changed when he spoke up and said, I'm nervous and I feel awkward about this, and he did it in a very down-to-earth and honest way, got that out of the way, and the whole conversation interaction was just fabulous as a result of it. And I thought, wow, that's just further evidence that if you just be yourself, say what's on your mind, all the rest of it, within reason, I think that that's how you connect really wonderfully well. And you and I, we see evidence of that every day. We all actually see evidence of that every day, whether it be someone on a television program being interviewed or someone talking about something on air, anywhere else, you know, and even reading about it in a book and just being authentic. It's great.
Griffo, getting to the pointy end as we wrap things up, a couple of things that, again, want to encourage listeners to do and I know worked for me. When I worked in advertising for 10 years early in my career, every year I was put through a public speaking course with the advertising agency I was with, and I didn't do a lot of public speaking back then, but I did a lot of presenting to clients. You know, it might be a room of one, two, some cases seven, eight, nine clients presenting ideas and strategy, and that helped me immensely. And I reflect back now, and just the idea of going out and seeking that kind of training was gold, because it just, again, helps you articulate your message. It helps you stand up in front of a crowd, feel what it's like. I still do a weird thing. Speaking of feeling, I'm into feeling, Griffo. I say I'm the emotional marketer. But when I go up, when I roll up to a room to present in, I actually, of course, I walk the stage before everyone comes in. I actually also walk around to every group of tables or along the rows of chairs and touch them and just center myself in that space. That's my woo-woo for today.
Yeah, that's weird.
But yeah, thanks there. Thanks for your support on that one.
I do exactly the same, mate.
Thank you. You know, yeah. So, we're two weirdos.
We're both freaks.
Freaks, you know. But again, just feel it. I think we underestimate that concept of feeling the space and getting used to it. And the other thing I would suggest is, do just go out and get some training. Even if you don't think you're going to do public speaking, the idea of getting training around that, or some media training or voice training, whatever it is, it just takes you out of your comfort zone.
Absolutely.
And opens your mind up to what's possible.
That is such an important point, isn't it? That, again, shift the energy in your business. If you're doing it a bit tough, well, try this. Maybe that's a different approach of getting out there and talking about it. But if I can add one more thing quickly to that, Timbo, I met T. Harv Eker in the States, the millionaire mindset guy, and I remember had a really nice chat to him about, nowadays he talks to 10,000 people, and we're having a conversation about how he got started. And I always remember him saying, he invited a few friends over for dinner, to come and watch him practice his first presentation. And they said, no way, Harv, we're not going to come and listen to you rave on for an hour. We got better things to do with our life. So he invited another group of friends over under the guise of coming over for dinner. So they're all sitting in the lounge room having a drink before dinner, and he just kind of flicked on the overhead projector in the corner and he just started presenting to this group of friends. And he said they've all looked around at each other like, well, Harv's obviously lost it, but we better not say anything. He could be on the edge. And he said that's how he practiced. He would dupe his friends into coming over and basically do a presentation and then get their feedback. And I thought, what a wonderful story. And he said he learned more about presenting in that environment with the toughest critics than he did speaking to 10,000 people on a stage every month in the States. And I thought, well, okay, that's a pretty cool bit of wisdom and advice there.
Yeah, love it. Now, Griffo, one last thing. I mean, it's a lot. I mean, this is a full-day workshop, really. I mean, what we're trying to cover, but my outcome of this episode is that there are going to be some business owners who do want to embark on some kind of speaking career, and it's like, okay, well, where? How? Well, where do I go? How do I get these opportunities? And, you know, if you want a stage, you want a live audience, then tap a chamber of commerce on the shoulder, a member association within your industry. Not-for-profits are always looking for speakers. But then go online and look at opportunities like video, like podcasting. And I mean getting interviews on podcasts or starting your own podcast. There's doing webinars, Google Hangouts, Facebook chats, media interviews. Like, there are so many opportunities to start practicing this speaking marketing strategy and getting out of your comfort zone.
Absolutely. Local banks that are doing events, getting people together, B&I clubs. There really are a lot where you can actually cut your teeth, aren't there, when you think about it. And that's where, certainly for me, that's where all of my speaking started. You know, it was all unpaid because I wasn't very good at it. And I would end up, I'd talk at the opening of an envelope. And there might be 10 people.
So many lines there. I'm not going there.
I know, but little bit by little bit, people go, oh, can you come and talk to our Rotary Club? My first presentations were like definitely Rotary Clubs and not-for-profits without a doubt. And they're really nice because they're so appreciative that you've given your time. That you're not going to have them sitting there scrutinising you and being a horrible audience. And you look at it as practice. But there's also now 50 people who know more about you and your business.
Correct.
And that's how I look at it. Every time I talk to an audience or do something, there's another 50, 100, 500,000 people that know about me, know about my books, know about my business, and maybe I've helped them today. And going into that presentation with a desire to actually help the people in the room in some shape or form is a another key element for me. I want to solve their problems. I don't want to just tell them my story. I want to inspire them. I want to solve their issues, challenges, let them know that they're human and we all make mistakes and all that kind of stuff. And a nice higher intent, I think.
Griffo, you're one of the coaches in the Key Person of Influence program, and I know that you're seeing a lot of people coming through that program. They're all finishing, they're all writing their 30,000-word book. They're getting partnerships and developing their profile. Just to finish off, and I'm putting you on the spot here, but any great examples of someone who has taken the whole speaking aspect of becoming a key person of influence and you know, really run with it?
There, a lot of them, actually, to be honest. We've got everyone from our mutual friend, Darren Finkelstein, who has written a couple of books now, working on his third one, and he's, you know, talking at boat shows. He's talking at launches of products. He's a radio announcer, again, a TV show. All those types of things that have all emerged from him writing a book, but also the fact that he can record his weekly weather report for Melbourne, Port Phillip Bay, all of these kind of things that really have all stemmed from that. Writing the book created a lot of energy and awareness about him and what he did. Then, of course, what followed from that was the people, hey, can you come and talk? Can you talk at our events? So he travels around Australia talking at boat shows, boating events, lifestyle shows, all of those kind of things.
Yeah.
And that's a prime example. We've got people that are doing that with time management, books and topics. We've got really niche things, everyone from their franchising, their cooking, their personal trainers. Everyone.
The point is you stick your head above the trench with some smart marketing, with some marketing that's going to get noticed. We talked about remarkable marketing with this fellow from Chick-fil-A earlier this week. And, again, that will get you noticed and that may well lead to speaking in itself. So you can actively seek it. But if you even for me, Griffo, like starting my podcast is actually the reason I now speak.
Really?
You know,
really?
A straight line relationship between starting a podcast and, you know, after a few years, someone tapped me on the shoulder, someone from a speaker's bureau and said, hey, listen, we've got a client who would love you to do a roadshow for a group of small business owners. And, you know, so some remarkable marketing, some smart marketing can even lead to a speaking career. So
yeah, very cool.
Wrapping things up, mate, because that voice of yours, it's not getting any better.
No.
I don't think it's deteriorated too much, but I think you've got a workshop to run today. So
that's right. Talk about being a presenter. I've got to go and present to 300 or 400 people about about how to work with speakers. And I'm going to be talking about how, and of course, to get contact with the audience, I'm going to tell them about how emotionally insecure we are.
Yeah, that's right.
How fragile we are. And I need a hug to get this started.
yeah. And please don't let them see your rider, because I understand it's 11 pages long and requires room temperature watermelon cutting triangles on the stage on a plinth in front of you or something, doesn't it?
But Floridian watermelons.
I thought it was Floridian watermelon. Goodness me. Well, that's another discussion in itself.
And a chimpanzee. let's move on quickly.
Hey, buddy, love your work. Always love doing an episode of Funny Business with you. A lot more upbeat than last episode where we talked about managing yourself through a personal or business crisis. But
I got some amazing feedback from that last episode, I must say, and I'm sure you did too. A lot of people really liked it when we got deep and dark.
Yeah.
And a bit, you know, that was a big, big topic. And I'm sure that we'll revisit some of those deeper topics as we move on. Today's one's, it was a nice feeling to be talking about something that you and I are both really, really passionate about and fired up about. And I hope that a lot of people listening felt that in our discussion today, and it's inspired them to go out and just give it a go. I love
your honey. Rod Stewart, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you. Hot Legs, is it Hot Legs? I've got no idea when it comes to music, have I? I'm going to just quit now while I'm not even close to being ahead. Thank you, Mr. Weed. Let me pour you a good long drink. Ooh, baby, don't you hesitate.
Tonight's the night. It's gonna be alright. 'Cause I love you, girl. Ain't nobody. Oh my goodness. I'm sorry, but I used to love that song as a young boy. It was quite naughty, I thought. Old Rock and Rod and that film clip. I don't know whether you remember it. I am showing my age, I know. Anyway, I digress. I do love a sing-along, though. Hey, did you enjoy that? If you did, before I share my top three tips, thanks to the good guys at Key Person of Influence, hit AG and I up on Twitter. Let us know. AG's Twitter handle is at AG Author. It's a word I always spell wrong, author. There's no second U in it, just in case you're wondering. Or at Timbo Reid, R-E-I-D. Let us know what you thought. Right, I'm a top three learnings from it, one of which we didn't even talk about, but I need to add. Now, these are brought to you by the good folk at Key Person of Influence. Grab their book over at keypersonofinfluence.com/Timbo. Number one, don't ignore the idea of presenting as a valid marketing strategy. Add it to your marketing arsenal. Break the rules. Think a bit different. Number two, go and get some training. Step outside of your comfort zone and get some speaker training, public presenting training, stand-up comedy training. Not that you need to be overly funny, but all this type of training will take you out of your comfort zone, and that's where the magic happens. Learning number three, thanks to the good guys at Key Person of Influence, identify the most expensive problem your prospects have that you can solve and then create a presentation that solves it. We didn't touch on this in our chat, but it's important. And along the way, start identifying the stories that support each point you make, okay? And build it out in PowerPoint or Keynote and just start to create that presentation that you could use at an event or on a webinar or wherever it may be. It's a good exercise to do. You got a question about this topic? I would love to hear it and I would love to answer it to move you forward. In fact, I've got an entire section inside the Small Business Big Marketing Forum dedicated to speaking and presenting over at crankmymarketing.com. A very wise soul once said, whatever you do, always give 100%. Unless, of course, you're donating blood. Oh, I do love a funny marketing motivational quote. Even if it just makes me laugh. Hey, we are almost at the end of episode 271. Plenty of marketing gold coming your way, though. Next episode, you'll discover how James Tostevin has become Australia's number one ranked real estate agent for the last 2 years. And let me tell you, this will not be an interview about how to become a real estate agent. Oh, no, not at all. It's much more about his business success secrets. It's a ripper. Hey, be sure to grab your free hard copy of The Key Person of Amazon. Timbo, hey, you get a bit excited. The Key Person of Influence Amazon bestseller over at keypersonofinfluence.com/Timbo. Audio production for this show, you guessed it, is done by the one and only Daryl Misson. The music bed created by organ player extraordinaire Lockie Dolly. If you want to surround yourself with motivated business owners, I'll see you inside the forum. If you want me to speak at your conference, that's what I do. I love that. Check out timreid.com.au. Until next week, that's me. I am Timbo Reid. I always have been. May your marketing be the best marketing. Bye for now.